Okay, today we'll discuss measures 6.3 paper, sericulture, subunit sericulture. So, going to the details about the sericulture, the subunit, so we have to know what is sericulture. I think you know about the basically what is sericulture. Sericulture, if we see briefly, the sericulture or silk farming is the commercial rearing of sericigenous insect for producing of silk. So, sericigenous insect means silk producing insect. So, sericulture is also known as agro-based and labor-intensive industry, ranked second to China. India ranked second to China, contributing 15.5% of world production. Provides direct employment to about 35 millions of people. Okay, so sericulture basically two different part. One is can say that's Malbari, and another is non-Malbari. Okay, non-Malbari. So if we see the varieties of silk, so the world four different varieties of silk, Malbari. Then Muga we have, then Tosor also we have two different types, temperate Tosor and tropical Tosor, and number four we have Eri silk. So these are the four different varieties of silk, Malbari, the insect Bombyx mori producing the Malbari silk. Similarly, Antheria assamensis helper, so produces Muga silk, and also known as Antheria assamensis, proposed the name by Westwood, and temperate tosser silk from Antheria proeli, and tropical tosser in India it is found Antheria mylita, then in Japan, Antheria yamaimai, and China, Antheria parini. So again, we have the another silk variety is Eri silk. So Eri silk, the name of the insect is Samia ricini donovan. So these four varieties of silk, apart from the Malbari, another three varieties together known as non-Malbari silk. So if we see the production scenario, global product silk production 1,52,868 metric ton, and China alone produces 82.42% and India 15.5%. If we see the Indian silk production in 2015 and 16, Malbari 20,434 metric ton. So 71.8%, then Tosor we produced that the period 2,818 metric ton, Eri 5,054 metric ton, and Muga 166 metric ton. And if we see the 2013 and 14 silk production in case of Assam, Malbari 23.4 metric ton, Eri 2012.70 metric ton, and Muga 118.04 metric ton. So we can say the sericulture is a multidisciplinary subject. If we see the scenario, or if we see here this trigram, the sericulture, we have zoology subject, because if we study the animal insect, then it is included under zoology. Similarly, because sericulture is host plant, so botany is there, then there biochemical analysis in case of insect and food plants, so we go for the biochemistry part. Then biotechnology also involved, similarly genetics and microbiology, disease related all study under microbiology. So, if we see the multipurpose uses of silk, then host plant, apart from the that food plant value, we can use another purposes like from host plant, fruit, root, bark, fuel wood also we can use as a food plant, from food plant. Also apart from that food plant we can use like this. So pupa also we can use as a pupal oil, pupal cake, then silkworm litter also we can use biogas or vermicomposting. So if we see the biodiversity, we know the variety and variability of life forms is popularly known as biodiversity. Then in case of seri biodiversity, so seri biodiversity refers to the variability in sericigenous insect and their host plants, which are economically and ecologically important and by and large forest based. So wild silk moth or non-mulberry silk moths, also known as boino silk, are in general not rare in captivity. So these are charismatic fauna, so beautiful fauna of the insect world, producing porous silk and exhibit variability of life, from eggs to adult with characteristically different physiological, morphological and feeding parameters among themselves. So if we see the biodiversity scenario of the world wild silk moth varieties, so present status is like this. So about 1861 species in 162 genera and 9 subfamilies in Asia and Africa subcontinent, we have 80 species. So Indian subcontinent from Himalayas to Sri Lanka, we have 50 species, and India alone we have 47 species of wild silk moth under 15 genera. And this is actually one report from myself also, in 2019 report from Nagaland, 15 species belonging to 8 genera. And in northeastern regions again we have studied, so 27 species under 13 genera. So that's all about the brief wild silk moth biodiversity of world. So we can say that the India or northeast India, about the four varieties, if we see the four varieties of silk, Malabari, then Muga, Tosar and Eri, we have beauties there. In northeastern region we have four varieties of silk. So if details about the silk moth species found in northeastern region of India, we have Antheria assamensis, then Antheria royali, Antheria proeli, Antheria prithi, Antheria species, Nobu, then Attacus atlas, Ectias silini. Attacus atlas, we all know that the world largest insect, atlas moth, then Ectias silini, Indian moon moth, Cricula triphenesteta, Samia ricini, then Samia keningi, Sonthonexia minas, Theophila religiosa, Drandomylas gracia, Lopa katinka, Ectias rhodopneuma, Bombex mandarina, Archaeotacus edwardsi, Antheria parini, then Antheria halferi, Antheria comta, Lebeda nobilis, Rhodonia neura, Bombex hotoni, Antheria mylita, Antheria neviti, Antheria castania and Lopa sicima. These are the 27 species of wild silk moth from reported from northeastern region of India. So these are the wild silk moth species. I'm giving the brief idea about the wild silk moth species in northeastern region because it is related to your according to your syllabus, because we have to know the sericulture. So we have to know the bioresources, seri bioresources in northeastern India and in India also. So these are the different varieties of silk moth found in northeastern region of India. Then these are the adult moth, and then larval stage, then cocoon stage. So these are again this I'm giving this because you have I think you have interest in different field in sericulture also. So few sir, you have to go how you can go. So that's why I'm giving this slide, because this particular species, this four species, or see Antheria assamensis wild, Antheria assamensis cultivated, Sonthonexia minas, Attacus, these are the varieties is available in our Nagaon also. So these are again the Anthurium mylita abundantly available in different location of Naugaon district, also Pricula trifinestata, Dotsemia canningi, so Semia ricini. These all varieties are available in the Naugaon. So because we have in according to your syllabus, we have to know the four varieties of silk in and their economics and their products. So before going to this, we have to know the their life cycle, their host plants. So if we briefly know about their life cycle or food plants one by one, if we go for the in case of Malbari we have only food plant, that's Moras elba and Moras. There's Moras also, different species are there, Moras indica, Moras elba. So this is the purely Malbari. Then we have Muga. So Muga, so far we have reported, if we see the record, then reported so far 10 different food plants. So along with this, food plants also divided in differently like so primary food plants we have sum and swallow. So sum is popularly known as Persia bombicina and swallow Persia monopetela or so okay. So secondary food plants we have Lychia salicifolia, or tertiary food plants we have Lychia cubeba. So Lychia cubeba popularly known as mezankodi food plant. So accordingly we have in case of Eri also we have different food plants so far reported. Eri also 10 different food plants are reported in northeastern region of India. So Eri we can see the primary food plants. So basically primary food plants castor. So castor scientific we have Ricinus communis. So Ricinus communis. So Ricinus communis castor food plants. So apart from these, another secondary food plants are there. So Heteropenex fragrans and Payam also. This is popularly known as Kesero Heteropenex fragrans. And number three, Payam we have. So Manihot Utilissima also we have, the tapioca. So these are the food plants of Aedes silkworm. Again, we have that the temperate tosser silkworm, also known as oak tosser, and Anthurium mylita tropical tosser, abundantly reared in Maharashtra and different part of India. So food plants is Arjun, Terminalia arjuna, Asan also another food plants. So these are the briefly about the food plants of so I am giving the brief idea about, because we have to go over details about the, well, we are discussing about the food plants of silkworm species wise, okay. So I am giving the briefly about the food plants. So I already mentioned that the sericulture is agro based industry. So cultivation of food plants purely agriculture based, and the end product what is a silk is purely industrial. So industrial origin, the production of silk and that weaving materials industrial based. So another important is there the life cycle of, in case of Anthurium assamensis, if we see the Muga silkworm, if we see the different stages right from the eggs and the first instar larva. So basically like other butterflies, in case of Muga silkworm life cycle also divided into four different stages, eggs, larva, pupa and adult. So eggs we have, then larval also, five larval stages are there, four molt and five larval stages are there. Then we have another cocoon. Inside the cocoon pupa is there, and then adult. So whole life cycle, the beauty is there in each and step of the life cycle. There are variety is diversity is there. So first instar in morphological, And accordingly, second instar larva also morphological differences are there. So each and every life, each and every stages of the life cycle, so diversity is there. So accordingly, if we see the commercial varieties of silk, I have already mentioned the Malabari is purely domesticated. It is most superior quality of silk. Most of the commercial silk produced in the world comes from this variety, and often silk refers to Malabari silk produced by Bombex Murray. These silkworms are completely domesticated and reared indoors and feed only the leaves of Malabari plant. Okay, so again we have another varieties of commercial silk, Muga silk. I have already mentioned that produced by the Antheria asamensis helper, Polyphagus insect, and its wild counterpart is found in foothills of Meghalaya, Arunachal Pradesh and Nagaland, which shows wide range of color morphism and volatilism. So far reported food plants 15. I have earlier mentioned that earlier reporter mentioned 10 food plants. So this is the latest report, 15 food plants are there. So main food plants of Sum, Swallow, Digloti and Mezangori. So again we have another important commercial varieties of silk. So Eri silk, produced by Eri silkworm Semiaricini donovan. So Eri silkworm of the genus Semia contain 19 species, out of which Semiaricini is domesticated. So over the world 19 Eri silkworm species are there. So India we have 3 different species are there. So and Semiaricini purely Semiaricini cultivated, then Semia keningi wild counterpart, and Semia fulva wild found in Andaman and Nicobar Island. So far 10 food plants are reported. So main food plants castor, keseru and trapioca. So these are the in larva also. So 6 color strains are there. So I am showing these are 6 color strains of Eri silkworm larva. Then again, so Eri silkworm also produce 2 different varieties of cocoon, white variety and red varieties of cocoon. So another important commercial varieties of silk is tussar silk. It consists of 2 types, tropical tussar and temperate tussar or oak tussar. So tussar silk is produced by silkworm Antheria myelita, which consists of 44 ecoraces available in India, and temperate tussar or oak tussar Antheria proeli feeds mainly on oak leaves, oak plants leaves. Okay, so here interesting is there that oak tussar or temperate tussar, which is reared in northeastern region of India or Jharkhand and other state, it is originally a hybrid species. So we know that Antheria royali wild tussar silk moth found abundantly in any India. Similarly, Antheria parini, tussar silk moth found in China. So Antheria proeli actually as a hybrid species comes from Antheria royali, which is found in northeastern region of India, and Antheria parini, a tussar silk moth species found in China. It is a hybrid species and known as Antheria proeli, which first time successfully hybrided by Jolie, M.S. Jolie, 1979. So it is a hybrid species and established species. So this particular species in our northeastern region, in Assam also, different hill states, and especially Manipur, they are rearing for production of tosar silk. So that we have the Kukan and yarn diversity. So basically these are the Anthera assamensis helper. Anthera assamensis, we know that basically then the primary food plants of Anthera assamensis is sum or Persia bombycina. So I have already mentioned that the tertiary food plants of Anthera assamensis is mezankori. So mezankori, the scientific name of the mezankori is Lycia cubeba. So feeding on Lycia cubeba, Muga silkworm produces different varieties of silk. We know that Muga means in Assamese word Muga. So it is in English it's brown color. So brown, golden yellow or golden brown. So feeding on mezankori food plants, Lycia cubeba, Anthera assamensis produces different colored silk, Muga silk, which is admired by and used by royal families of the Ahom kingdom. So it is colored as a whitish, a creamy white color, and natural dazzling is there. So, and denier, which denier is a unit, to measure or the fineness of thread, silk thread, denier. So denier is a unit to measure the fineness of the silk thread. So the denier also fine. So that's why that the feeding on mezankori food plants, Muga silkworm produces a high quality, finer quality silk, is known as popularly mezankori silk. And that from that mezankori silk, so nowadays the availability, the scarcity of that mezankori food plants due to different regions, there is no abundantly available mezankori food plants in Assam. So that's why that mezankori silk production also deteriorate, and I should say that this the present status, no mezankori silk production is going on in Assam. But in our neighboring hilly state, that the particular plant abundantly available, that mezankori plant. So we have lots of scope to produce that mezankori silks again, because it was earlier in the during Ahom kingdom that mezankori silk was admired. That mezankori silk only, mezankori silk woven clothes only worn by that Ahom royal families only. So we have lots of scope to revive or rejuvenate the mezankori silk. So again we have that Anthera royally jolly, that cocoons and yarn. So again we have Actia silini. So I have already mentioned that apart from the, we have commercially four varieties of silk only we are commercially exploited, other than which we have I have mentioned that in northeastern region of India so far 27 species are reported, but only four from the, that from 27 numbers we have so far, we have able to commercially exploit only four varieties of, but other species also lots of scope to go for the commercial rearing or commercial production. So Actia silini also, from Actia silini also we can go for the silk thread or silk fiber, or we can go for the commercial production also. If we see the yarn like Mugas also, that Actia silini also produces golden yellow colored silk. And first time from northeastern region of India, I should say that the first time I am able to produce the silk from the Actia silini. So again we have Anthera royally. I have already mentioned that Anthera royally. So Anthera royally, wild tosar silk moth abundantly found in different geographical part of the northeastern region of India. So but that particular species also so far not commercially exploited, but we have lots of scope to exploit for commercial, commercially, for commercialization, we have lots of scope. So, if we see that, the anterior royally cocon, say the anterior royally cocon, double layered cocon. So, one floss layer is there, and inside the floss layering, another cocon is there. So, it is a double layered cocon, it is very peculiar. So, that's why we have lots of diversity in, we definitely we know that the northeastern region of India, one of the biodiversity hotspots. But even sericulture also, we have that particular prospect that in sericulture also lots of diversities are there. So, that's why I am mentioning here that anterior royally double layered cocon, and anterior royally I am mentioning again and again, because that anterior royally and anterior priony hybrid species from anterior royally and anterior priony, a hybrid species is anterior royally. So, which is commercially reared in Imphal and other hilly states of Assam. So, again we have another species that Attacus atlas. So, we have known that from Attacus atlas also produces phagra silk, but in Indian subcontinent and in Assam and northeastern region, that Attacus atlas is not reared in commercially not reared, but in China and Indonesia, and that Attacus atlas also reared for commercialization. From Attacus atlas they produces phagra silk, and then from phagra silk they produces a different type of decoration matrix and other purposes they use that phagra silk. So, again we have Samia keningi also on different food plants, I have recorded an interesting is there that Samia keningi also feeds on Mejankuri food plant. So, feeding on different food plants, they are differences are there. That's why I am mentioning again and again that there are lots of work we have to do. They are in sericulture chemistries, they are biochemistries, there why that color is different. So, that we have to explore why that the color, the silk color is different, feeding on different food plants. So, definitely we have to examine, we have to evaluate what are the characteristics, what is the behind reason. So, colors are feeding on different food plants, the colors, then ultimately production of cocon, then quality and quantity of the silk also vary. So, again we have the different another species that Samia ricini. So, Samia ricini Donu Bhanjo, only species in that Eri silkworm, because I have already mentioned that under Samia 19 species are there. So, from 19 species, only species is commercially reared species Samia ricini. And interesting is there that the Samia ricini abundantly reared in Assam traditionally from time immemorial. Assam and northeastern region of Indian people, they traditionally reared that Eri silkworm. For in generally we know that Eri silkworm pupa is different tribal people and other different people also fits as a delicious food. So, take as a delicious food. So, that Samia ricini, that apart from this silk, apart from this silk production, though this pupa also especially that the tribal and other people also take as a delicious food. So, interesting is there that I have mentioned that 19 species of that Eri silkworm under Samia genus, only that Samia ricini is commercially reared, and interesting is there. So, 90% production of the Samia ricini is from northeastern region of India, especially Assam. So, another species is Theophila religiosa. It is also abundantly found in wild condition. So, another species that the Cricula trifenestrata, from Cricula trifenestrata also we can go for the the extraction of silk and commercialization of silk, because interesting is there that that Semia, that the Cucula trifinestata, it is not commercially reared in India and other part of the our country and northeastern region, but it is commercially reared in China and Indonesia for decoration mattress and other purposes. But I am just giving one example here in Assam also, while I am visiting that Boku area. So Boku, we have known that that sericulture in herbs also they are there. Most of the people they go for the production of silk and seed also. That I have, while I am visiting that Boku, I have seen that one farmer extracted the silk from the Cricula trifinestata. So if he can, that definitely it is another prospect for commercialization of Cricula silk also. So I am giving this entire the diversity of the silk moth and cocoon as well as a prospect of the wild silk moth in northeastern region of India, because it is under your syllabus we have to discuss all these sort of things, but I am giving that entire syllabus as that, because if we go for, if you have interested in foreign part, then you can go for the further study. That's why I am giving the latest information about sericulture and silk diversity in northeastern region of India, and especially Assam and northeastern region. So one interesting thing I have to mention here, that Muga silk of Assam got a geographical indication right in 2007 August. So one interesting is there, I have mentioned already that Muga silk, so Muga silk of Assam got geographical indication right, so in 2007 August, so it is a pride of Assam. So if you see the characteristics of different silk varieties in found in Assam and northeastern region of India, we can say world also, in world expensive silk, we can say that Muga silk. So if we see the color of the Muga silk, golden yellow or creamy white, which I have mentioned that Phaedon mejankuri, so Muga or Anthuria assamensis produces one type of silk is which is admired for its color and that the dazzling for specially and woven and wear by that the royal families of Ahom kingdom, that the mejankuri silk or mejankuri fed Muga silk, creamy white color. So if we see the filament length in generally in case of Muga, that 316 to 470 meters, then if we see the denier 3.94 to 4.73, then accordingly we have another species which is not commercially exploited, that Actia silini. Also colors golden yellow to creamy white, and the filament length is 134 to 143, and denier is 7.72 to 7.94. So accordingly Anthuria proily light brown to creamy white, then the filament length is 352 to 457, then denier 4.33 to 5.03, Anthuria royally accordingly light brown colored or to creamy white, then that filament length is 275 to 326, and then you are 5.00 to 5.05, then accordingly Anthuria assamensis or Anthuria species novo creamy white to whitish brown color, that the filament length 328 to 395, and that denier 3.0 to 3.5. So that characteristics of spun silk yarn of certain species of wild silk moth found in northeastern region. I am giving example of northeastern region because I just we have lots of in sericultural biodiversity in northeastern region of India. So I am just giving this examples to grow the interest of sericulture so further we can go for the higher study or for other that entrepreneurship development based on sericulture day. So I am giving example, more example in northeastern region of India. So accordingly, if we see the spun silk like Attacus atlas, so color grayish brown, then the degumming lost 15.7%, so yarn yield 30.4%, then Cricula triphenestrata color brownish gray, degumming lost 46.6%, then yarn yield 27.10%, then semi-aricini again the color whitish gray to creamy white, then the degum lost 23.5%, then yarn yield 72.86%, and semi-acaningi again we have color so gray to brick red color, then degum lost 26.5 and yarn yield 58.33%. So if we see the yarn yield maximum in Semilla ricini, so if we see the commercial product of the silk, why we need silk? Why we need silk? Every day we are using silk. I think you know that we are every day using silk. So where, and if we ask the where we are using silk, if we see the medical application of the silk, every while stitching in medical operational purposes, we are using silk. So silk also used as a biomaterial. If we see the commercial, apart from these are the dress materials from Muga silk product, then again we have Eri silk product, then Tosor silk product, these are the dress materials and Eri silk product. So silk also used in cosmetic world. So silk product in the cosmetic world different in China and Japan, they are from silk they are using in different cosmetic products. So again we have made lots of medical application of silk. So we want to give example. IIT Guwahati also they prepare scaffold in biomedical application of silk. If we see another important recent research development, if we see the silk based artificial human eardrum, one Assamese scientist, so he is Dr. Rangam Raskua, that they develop artificial eardrum from silk fiber. So Assamese scientists working on eardrum perforation project at Deakin University, Australia. So a team of Australian scientists at Deakin University, Australia, headed by Dr. Rangam Raskua, has been working on an innovative concept to help those who have hearing loss due to eardrum perforation. So they developed silk-based membrane material for an artificial human eardrum. So silk which I have mentioned, that the silk also biomedical application. So these are the different application apart from the dress materials, because we know that the silk is used mainly that the clothes and other woven materials, but apart from this silk also different lots of the medical application and byproduct utilize. If we see the different byproduct also from silk pupa, also apart from the delicacy food, so silk pupa also used for preparation of fish food. So these are the some important aspect of silk. So as on now I am giving a rough idea about the silk diversity and the silk from silk they are the production and potential of the silk varieties and found in different region and different parts of the world, and especially in northeastern region of India and Assam. So these are the briefly about the diversity and varieties of silk. So now we can go for the, according to your syllabus we have to study the rearing performance and rearing of silkworm, and they are food plants of silkworm. If we see the Muga food plant, if we see the in case of Muga, so if we go for the Muga, then Muga, that if we go the systematic position, the systematic systematic position, if we go the go for the systematic position, so phylum, we all know that the phylum is arthropoda, then class insecta, then we have order that the lepidoptera, then family, we Saturnidae family. So these are the systematic position of Muga silkworm. So before going to these details, life history or rearing of the silkworm, we have to know the systematic position, because each and every species, their life history and their feeding parameters, we have to discuss differently. So I have mentioned already that the Muga silkworm, Antheria assamensis, Antheria assamensis helper, their systematic position. Then if we see the, before going to this, their life history, so we have to briefly mention their food plants. So if we, I have already mentioned their food plants. So food plants, if we see the food plants, so Muga silkworm food plants, so far reported 15 numbers of food plants across the world. So among the food plants, Parsia bombicina, popularly known as sum. Sum plants are primary food plants. And another secondary food plants are there, Shualu, Litsia monopetala, Litsia monopetala, secondary food plants. Then tertiary food plants, I have already mentioned that tertiary food plants, Litsia salicifolia, popularly known as Diglotti, and another important secondary food plants, Litsia cubeba, or Litsia citrata, popularly known as Mezankori. So these are the food plants of Muga silkworm. I am mentioning this because before going to this life history or rearing, we have to know the food plants. So these are the briefly about your, according to your syllabus, sericulture. So sericulture, I have already mentioned that non-Malbari and Malbari, both part I have just giving idea about the sericulture, and there are four varieties of silk. Also I have already mentioned that in the world, four varieties of silk are available, and in India and northeastern region of India, interesting is there. I'm just reviewing what I have already talking and discussing. So that interesting is there, four varieties of silk and available in northeastern of northeastern region of India. And interesting is there that Muga is monopoly in Assam. It is rare northeastern of region of India, especially Assam, and 99.9% production from Assam only. So according to our syllabus, we have to discuss the life cycle, rearing and food plants of Eri and Muga silkworm. So now we are going to for the Eri silkworm, one by one, Eri silkworm. So Eri silkworm, if we see the Eri silkworms, I have already mentioned that 19 species across the world, 19 species are there, and Semia ricini, which is commercially reared species across the globe. So scientific name, Semia ricini Donovan. So if we see the, because you know all that there systematic position we see systematic position phylum from phylum arthropoda then the class insecta order lepidoptera then family saturnidae and type which we are going to study that samia erysilcum semiaricini normal. So according to the syllabus we have to discuss the life history or life cycle of erysilcum. So like other lepidopteran insect or butterfly, so erysilcum life cycle also complete eggs, larva, pupa inside the cocoon and adult. So four stages are there. So if we go for the eggs, so in this life cycle we have to discuss about their the characteristics of eggs. So color of the eggs, then incubation period from laying to hatching. So that period is incubation period. Again we have in larva also we have five larval stages there and four molt and five larval stages, then pupa. So inside the cocoon, pupa, then adult male, female there. So we will be going the details about their life cycle in their characteristics. So I am just showing the commonly available host plants of erysilcum that this is found in Nagaon also, that's why I am giving the example. So that castor, which is popularly known as Aragus inasamis, so Ricinus communis, then Trafioca simulualo in Assamis, then the Manihot utilissima, then Keseru we have Heteropenes fragrans, then Alianthus excelsa also available in Nagaon also. So if we go for the details about the rearing of the erysilcum, so right from the we have to start the grainage operation. So traditional and scientific rearing we have to mention in case of erysilcum rearing also. So traditionally grainage practices are like this. So villagers or farmers, so what they are doing, they are tied the cocoon in a cloth and hanging like this, and so that moth will be emerged, and after emergence they will lay eggs there. So in case of scientific rearing or scientific practices of grainage in case of erysilcum, so traditionally erysilcum were allowed to lay eggs in cloths, but in this method less number of eggs produced and diseased eggs cannot be eliminated. So but if moths were tied in khorikas, like khorikas means it is a device, egg laying device, stick made up of thrust, more numbers of eggs produced and diseased eggs can be eliminated easily. So this is the difference between scientific and scientific rearing and traditional rearing. So we have to mention while we are going for description of this that the rearing performance, then you have to mention both the traditional and scientific rearing. So accordingly this is the scientific how we have to tie the moth in khorikas, just a demonstration, and this is the eggs. So after hatching, so generally after hatching, so that the young larvas will be given the tender leaves accordingly in the tray, then these are the different stages of larval stages. So tray feeding of erysilcum and cleaning. So how the erysilcums feeds in the generally two different methods are there after third instar larva, and from third instar, in some farmers from third instar larva they feeds erysilcum in bunch. They tie the different the food plants like a castor or casero and branch, and accordingly they feed the larva like this. So these are the tray feeding and branch feeding. So here I am showing the branch feeding, how they are feeding and cleaning. So these are the field demonstration. I am just giving the example how in hairy silkworms reared in different villages and different farmers. So I am just giving example. So cocooning of hairy silkworm. So like the cocooning, for cocooning, dry and hard leaves, farmers generally use dry and hard leaves, are banana leaves and mango leaves and jackfruit leaves, dry and semi-dry leaves for cocooning of the hairy silkworm, and these are the cocooning devices and popularly known as jalis in Assamese. So post-cocoon operation. So post-cocoon operation, like they are after the 5 to 6 days of the cocooning, generally up to 8 days. So they are harvesting cocoon like this, and after that, some farmers, because it is open-mouthed cocoon, if pupa will be extracted from the cocoon, then also we can go for the that is spinning of the hairy silk. So they sell the hairy pupa like this. So these are the harvesting and grainage of the hairy silkworm. So accordingly, degumming process. So how to boiling the hairy cocoons? We know the that sodium bicarbonate and also that soap also. So boiling of hairy cocoons with soap and alkali. So baking powder or soda. So boiling of hairy cocoons, then washing of boiled hairy cocoons for further processes. So these are the preparation of cocoon cakes for degumming of hairy cocoons and spinning of degum hairy fiber. So how we go for the extraction of silk thread, hairy silk thread. So these are the different, I'm just giving nowadays different NGOs and from our college also we are initiative some program for to promote hairy culture as mass and mass people. So there's a different training and demonstration program also we have organized to train up the farmers in rural farmers. So these are the some snapshot of which training is going on. So just I'm estimated, so economic benefit from a hairy rearing. So if we see the scenario, generally I have already mentioned that these are the multivoltaic. So throughout the year, five to six crops can be easily reared in case of hairies also. If we see the scenario and one rearer, so throw six crop 90,420.5 rupees per year they can able to earn from the rearing or culture of hairy silkworm. So before ending this class, I am just sum up the what I have discussed in this class. So basically, so today we are going to know that what is sericulture. So different commercial varieties of silk we have mentioned, and apart from this we have the present scenario diversity, biodiversity of wild silk moth or silk moth species entire globe and northeastern region of India. And I have already mentioned that there is a northeastern region of India, especially Assam, on a potential for sericultural growth and development of sericulture activities. So why I am giving, so according to a syllabus we have to discuss all these sort of things up to entrepreneurship development we have to discuss. So before concluding this class, I am just sum up this, because just today we have discussed that the sericulture, about the sericulture activities, diversity of sericulture, and lastly we have mentioned the rearing practices of hairy silkworm and rearing practices of hairy silkworm, life cycle of hairy silkworm, and traditional and scientific way. So in accordingly, like ERI also, we have to discuss the Muga silkworm life cycle and the rearing practices and their commercial products and their diseases, prevention and preventive measures also. And we have to discuss also that their environmental condition of silkworm rearing and spawns and spawn and reeling silk also. So before ending above, I am just giving some terms, because this is very related in case of silkworm. So I have mentioned that DFL. So we have to know this DFL, disease free layings. After laying the eggs, moth will be examined under microscope. Under microscope, whether their disease symptoms are there or not. If it is not, then we can say disease free laying. So another term I have mentioned, denier. So denier is a unit to determine the fineness of the silk thread. So accordingly, I have mentioned that khorika. Khorika is an egg laying device. So another term also I have mentioned here that tray. It is a rearing device, so bamboo made tray also there, so bunch feeding. So another one term also I have mentioned, multivoltine, so univoltine. Multivoltine, univoltine. So before go for the multivoltine or univoltine, we have to know the what is voltinism. So voltinism, if throughout the year particular insect complete their life cycle once one time, that it is known as univoltine. Or if more than one, if it is two times, then two bivoltine. If it is three, complete their life cycle throughout the life, three, then trivoltine, and more than that, it is multivoltine. So these are the term you have to know before going to all these sericultural activities.